So, dear colleagues, members of the examination committee, ladies and gentlemen, and dear candidates, on behalf of the Faculty of Engineering and Architecture, it's a pleasure to welcome you to this public doctoral examination in digital format, where Mr. Hannes Mareen will defend his doctoral dissertation entitled Pirates of the Film Industry, The Curse of the Forensic Watermark, in view of obtaining the academic degree of Doctor of Computer Science Engineering. In its meeting of December 16th of last year, the Faculty Council of the Faculty of Engineering and Architecture has appointed the following examination board. As voting members, Professor Dr. Engineer Mark Pickering of the University of New South Wales in Canberra, Australia. Professor Pickering is excused for today's meeting. Dr. Engineer Jan de Kok, Director of Codec Development at Sina Media, an enterprise specialized in video technology. Dr. Engineer Patrick de Smet from NICC, het Nationaal Instituut voor Criminalistiek en Criminologie. Professor Jan Aalterman, affiliated to two departments at Ghent University, the Department of Physics and Astronomy of the Faculty of Sciences and the Department of Telecommunication and Information Processing of the Faculty of Engineering and Architecture. And Professor Bjorn de Sutter from the Department of Electronics and Information Systems of the Faculty of Engineering and Architecture. Furthermore, we have the supervisors of the candidate, Professor Peter Lambert and Professor Glenn van Wallendaal, both also from the Department of Electronics and Information Systems. And finally, myself, Henny de Schepper, Director of Studies of this faculty and Chair of the Examination Board. A warm welcome, first of all, to all the members of the Examination Board, and I would like to take the opportunity to thank you all for your willingness to accept our invitation to take part in this examination board and for all the efforts you have already done in reading the dissertation, writing a report, being present at the meetings and questioning the candidates. Indeed, according to the faculty's regulations, there has already been a first meeting of the examination committee, the so-called internal or private defense, a few weeks ago on the 4th of March, which also took place in entirely digital format due to the COVID pandemic. During this first session, the candidate was thoroughly questioned by all members of the examination board, including Professor Pickering, who is excused for today. And at that occasion, it was unanimously decided to grant Mr. Mareen admission to the second part of the examination, the so-called public defense, which you are attending now, and this unconditionally, meaning that no mandatory changes to the dissertation were imposed. However, the candidate was encouraged by the members of the board to include some of their remarks and suggestions in the final redaction of the text, which he did. Of course, I not only wanted to welcome the members of the examination board, but also everyone, family, friends, and colleagues of Hannes, who are also following this defense online, an open online meeting which has been foreseen in order to guarantee the public character of this examination. The procedure of the present meeting is as follows. Shortly, I will invite Mr. Mareen to present an overview of his research in about 45-50 minutes. Then a final round of questioning by the examination board will follow, and we will try to conclude by some interaction with the public. So interventions and questions from the public will also be very welcome. And I will explain later on how we will proceed for this. Afterwards, the board will retire, meaning that we will migrate to another virtual meeting to deliberate, and we will come back to you afterwards to announce the result. Before passing the floor to Hannes, I will still mention a few aspects of his CV. Hannes Mareen received the Bachelor of Computer Science in 2014 and the Master of Computer Science Engineering in 2017, both from Ghent University. Since then, he pursued a PhD degree at IDLab, a research group jointly within Ghent University and IMEC, with financial support of the Research Foundation Flanders, FWO, as a strategic basic research PhD fellow. In 2020, he was a visiting research fellow at the University of New South Wales in Canberra. In his PhD research, Hannes investigated video watermarking and compression. He has co-authored 4 journal articles, while 2 more are submitted. He has contributed to 4 international conferences and published a popularizing science article in EOS magazine. Additionally, in collaboration with a colleague, he demonstrated the vulnerability of the visible watermarks in the Comdom app of Telenet. Finally, for his research, he won 2 Best Poster Awards and the Agoria Prize 2017. Hannes, may I invite you to present your work? The floor is yours. Just a moment. I would like to invite everyone, including the members of the examination board, to switch off the cameras while Hannes is presenting so that everyone can fully concentrate on what he is saying. Thank you. So Hannes, now the floor is really yours.
All right, thank you. Let's hope there will be no technical problems during this presentation. Is everybody able to see the slides?
I can see it.
All right, perfect. So welcome everybody to my public PhD defense. As you may already know, the title of my PhD thesis is Pirates of the Film Industry, The Curse of the Forensic Watermark. And as you may suspect, I'm going to talk about Pirates of the Caribbean. And I will start with discussing how can we watch a movie such as Pirates of the Caribbean? Well, I have a Netflix subscription, so the first thing I would do is I would try to find it on Netflix. So I open my browser, Google Chrome, I go to Netflix.com, and I type in the search bar Pirates of the Caribbean. But I don't see any of the results to be Pirates of the Caribbean. And that is because it's not on Netflix. So I have to search somewhere else. So I go to Google and I ask, how can I watch Pirates of the Caribbean? Well, Google tells me I need to go to Disney Plus. I need a subscription of Disney Plus to be able to watch this movie. So yeah, I can pay for yet another subscription of a streaming service, or I can ask my good friend Pierre to share his password with me, and then I can play my favorite movie, Pirates of the Caribbean, The Curse of the Black Pearl, hence the title of this thesis. So yeah, we can start watching this Disney movie, but then I noticed something. The quality of this movie was actually not so high. That was because I was receiving a low resolution version of this video. It was only 720p, while my computer monitor, my computer screen, it could handle 1080p, so full HD, or even 4K. And so, yeah, this is not so nice because me or my friend Pierre is paying for a subscription up to 4K, but I'm only seeing a 720p video. So this is not so nice. So why is the resolution so low? And that is because of digital rights management, or DRM for short. So Disney Plus does this to secure their videos. When a Disney Plus sends a movie such as Pirates of the Caribbean to me, to a user, and we want to see it on our screen, then we don't simply send exactly the copy. We first lock this video using DRM, and then only my application has the key to unlock this video. And now there are different types of locks, and you can compare this to locking your bike. When I have an expensive bike, I wouldn't use a cheap lock to lock this bike because I would be scared that somebody easily breaks the lock and I don't have a bike anymore. So instead, I would use a better lock, a more expensive lock that is not easy to break. If I have an old bike, on the other hand, I wouldn't mind using this cheap lock because even if they would steal the bike, it's not so valuable to me. And now the same holds for DRM. In Google Chrome and Firefox, for example, the DRM services, you can compare them to a cheap lock. And that's why Disney Plus decided that you should only get a low resolution version, so that if somebody breaks this lock, which can be done relatively easily, then they only have access to this low resolution version. So it's less valuable. On the other hand, if we go to another browser, such as Edge, or we install the Disney Plus application on Windows 10, then the DRM software there is of much better quality. It's much more secure. So it's like a strong lock. And then, of course, then they trust that the users cannot break the DRM and send a higher resolution video to them. However, with enough effort and with enough time, even these strong locks can often be broken. In practice, this often happens. So then we end up with a broken lock, and pirates can also access the higher resolution versions anyway. And so we can go to the Pirate Bay, a website for illegal videos, or not only for illegal videos, but you will find a lot of them on there. And we can type in Pirates of the Caribbean, and we can find all of the movies in as high as the quality as we want. But as you may remember from about 20 years ago, I want to show you this small video. So piracy, it's a crime. It's you're not allowed to illegally download these videos. But on the other hand, if I do it legally, the DRM, it's annoying. And not only is it annoying because, I want to be able to watch a movie in a high quality. I can do it if I use a different browser or something else, but I think I shouldn't even have to change the browser to do this. But also the DRM is not secure enough. So on Google Chrome, it's not secure enough and you're getting a low resolution. And even on the more secure DRM, eventually can be broken as well. So now the question is, how can we secure videos when DRM fails? Or in general, if we don't even have DRM, how can we alternatively secure these videos? And spoiler alert, this can be done using forensic watermarking, since this is what my thesis is all about. So let's think that we don't have DRM, and we have Will, Elizabeth, and Jack, and we want to send the movie to these three people, and only these three people can see it. Nobody else can. So we can simply send a copy of the movie to them, right? It's simple. But now if one of them is malicious and he leaks or she leaks this video on the Pirate Bay, then suddenly all of the peasants can also watch this video, even though they are not allowed. They didn't pay for it, for example. So this is what we don't want. However, since we send the same video to every one of these people, we don't know who was the pirate, who leaked this video. So we can do this better. We can do this with forensic watermarks. So what is a forensic watermark? Here we see a visible text in the lower left corner stating the receiver ID or the watermark ID. So in this case, it's number 3 for Jack. So this means that instead of sending the same copy to all of the users, we send a slightly unique version of the video to each user. So number 1 for Will, number 2 for Elizabeth, and number 3 for Jack. And now if one of them decides to leak their video on the Pirate Bay, we can simply read out the watermark.
Well, well, Jack Sparrow, isn't it?
Captain Jack Sparrow, if you please, sir.
So we know by just reading the watermark number 3 that Captain Jack Sparrow was in fact the pirate.
You are without doubt the worst pirate I've ever heard of.
But you have heard of me.
So Jack Sparrow, he's the worst pirate that you've ever heard of if he didn't do anything about this obvious watermark obstructing our view. So we have this watermark receiver ID 3, Jack. Well, we can also do an attack on this watermark. We can simply cover it with a red box, or we can blur it so that the watermark is not visible anymore and we don't know who leaked the video.
Gentlemen, m'lady, you will always remember this as the day that you almost caught Captain Jack Sparrow.
So, okay, we almost captured Captain Jack Sparrow, but he was too smart for us and he deleted the visual watermark in the video. And you may think that this visible watermark, it's not a very good approach to do watermarking, and you're right. But actually, it did happen in practice. Here we see a Game of Thrones video that I downloaded illegally a couple of years ago on the Pirate Bay. And we can see in the introduction of this that there is a blurred watermark. If I zoom in, we can see this blurred watermark. So there was an actual visible watermark there stating something like number 3, Jack Sparrow, or Captain Jack Sparrow. But this pirate simply blurred the watermark before leaking it on the Pirate Bay so that nobody knew who actually was the leaker. So this is an example of how watermarking should not be done. So now the question is, what are some requirements for an actual good forensic watermark? Well, so first, if we think that in this case, let's make an analogy, we want to send a video of the ocean and there is this annoying ship obstructing our view. So the ship is now a representation for the visual watermark. So number 3 here. Well, the watermark should not be visible. We should not even see it. It should not be there. We shouldn't see it at least. And it should not be weak. You should not be able to destroy the watermark easily. Instead, the watermark should be invisible. We shouldn't even know that it's there. It should be hidden under the surface of the ocean. But while we don't see it, it should actually be there. If the computer wants to, it should be able to detect the watermark. This means that the watermark should be robust. And robust, what does this mean? Well, it should survive attacks by pirates. If pirates know that the watermark is there and they try to delete the watermark, well, they should not be able to do this very easily. Lastly, also, the watermark should be scalable. Even if we have to send a watermarked version to hundreds or thousands of people, this should be able to be done in a reasonable time. So it should be quick. So now the title of my thesis was Pirates of the Film Industry, the Curse of the Forensic Watermark, but actually it's the Curses of the Forensic Watermark. I'm talking about three curses. The first one is the lack of robustness. So again, this means that existing watermarking techniques, they struggle with a lack of robustness. For example, the visual watermarking technique, we can simply blur it and then the watermark is deleted. Secondly, the impact on the visual quality. Existing methods often are not completely invisible. They have an objective impact on the visual quality. This means that either they decrease the video quality, which we don't want it to happen. We don't want to receive a more pixelated video just because there's a watermark in there. And also, it should not increase the video file size. Knowing that Netflix is last year was responsible for about 11% of global internet traffic, so this is a huge amount of data that it's using. If Netflix suddenly uses 10% more megabytes to send their videos to all of their users, then suddenly the global internet traffic would increase with a full percentage, which on a global scale is really a lot. So we don't want the watermark to increase the video file size, of course. Then thirdly, we have these scalability issues. And what does this mean? When we have a video that we want to send to, let's say, 1,000 people, we can create 1,000 different watermarked versions of this video. And then before sending it to the people, we also need to compress each of these watermarked videos. And this compression is very slow. It's very complex. So if we have to do it 1,000 times, it's not scalable. We can't do this very quickly. So now, what is this video compression that I'm talking about? Because some of you may not be aware that this is actually happening. So first we need to think, what is a video? Here there is a small video segment from Game of Thrones of 8 seconds. So what is this video exactly? Well, a video is just a bunch of frames. It's a lot of frames played right after the other. Typically in video, we have, for example, about 25 frames per second that if we show it quickly enough, our brain perceives it as a smooth motion. 25 frames per second. Well, for a 1-hour episode of Game of Thrones, this would be 90,000 frames. So this is really a lot. Then one image, it's a lot of pixels. If we zoom in on this image, we can keep on zooming in and keep on zooming in. Then we can distinguish each individual pixel. So typically in a full HD video with a resolution of 1080p, then we have about 2 million pixels. And each individual pixel is one color. So here we have the color brown, a certain brown, and then we have a bit lighter brown, and always lighter brown. So every pixel has their own color. But now, what is actually a color? If you remember from kindergarten, you were able to mix some different colors of paint together so that you can create new colors. Well, this is the same in video. If we just have a red, green, and blue color, we can combine them to create all of the colors that we're seeing on our screen. So we have a red, a green, and a blue channel that together they form the colored video. And this red, green, and blue, each of them take one byte to store on your computer. So from RGB, red, green, and blue, you might have heard already that this is how we are seeing on our screens. But in video compression, typically we use Y, U, and V. So this is basically the same concept as red, green, and blue. But now the Y channel is the black and white channel. And the U and the V channel, they are some other color channels that when we combine them, we get this colored video. But all right. So storing every pixel is inefficient. If we have 1 hour of video, we need about 90,000 frames, 2 million pixels per frame. and 3 bytes per pixel. So this would take about 540 gigabytes for a 1 hour video. So for one episode of Game of Thrones, we need a separate hard drive. Or let's say about 100 DVDs for one episode. So this is really not doable. That's why we do video compression. How do we do video compression? Well, you might have heard about compression already, for example, to a .zip file. When we have here an uncompressed YUV file of about 500 megabytes, this is just the 8-second clip that I was showing you before. So half a gigabyte for 8 seconds of video, this is not doable. So we compress it. We can simply do this in Windows. We can compress it to a zipped folder. And then we get a .zip file of only 180 megabytes. So this is already better, but still 180 megabytes for 8 seconds of video, that's not really doable. We still need too many DVDs for one episode of Game of Thrones. So that's why we compress it to, for example, MP4 file, and then it's only 1 megabyte anymore. And in this way, we can use a video encoder to make a 500 gigabyte uncompressed file into a 1 gigabyte MP4 file. And this video encoder, as I said before, it's very complex. It does a lot of calculations to do this compression very efficiently. And I will quickly go over how a video encoder does this on a high level. So, as I said before, a frame is just a bunch of pixels, but we can group these pixels together. Pixels of the same color, we can group them together, for example. So the video encoder tries to decide on some block structure to divide a frame of the video into blocks of pixels. And then every block of pixels can be predicted using other blocks of pixels. For example, this one here, we see some brown colors going to a more yellowish white color. Well, the blocks next to it are actually kind of the same. They are just moved slightly. So instead of saving every separate pixel of this block, we can simply say, well, this block is the same as the previous block. Every pixel is just shifted slightly to the bottom or slightly to the left or something like that. So that is how the video encoder tries to make some decisions about how to group pixels in blocks and how to predict every block using the other blocks. And we don't only do this with blocks to the left and to the right, but we can also do this with blocks in different frames. This is the first frame of the video, and this is the second frame of the video. So if I go back and forth between them, you can see that they are kind of the same. It's just that it's moved slightly to the right. And this is what the video encoder also sees. And he just says, well, copy the block from the previous frame just slightly to the left, something like this. And this is basically what a video encoder does on a very low level, trying to predict the video as efficiently as possible. And this is how we get an uncompressed video of 500 gigabyte that looks very good into a compressed video, an MP4 file of 1 gigabyte that still looks very good. We can't really see the difference as a human between the two videos that I just showed you. But even though we can't really see the difference, there are actually many small mistakes being made. Here, this is a visualization of the small mistakes or the compression artifacts that are being made during video compression. So we can see that the blue color, this means that there are no differences between the compressed and uncompressed video, while the green and the red, or there are no red areas in this case, they represent some bigger changes, some big compression artifacts. Still, we don't see them in this case. So there are some compression artifacts, and that is because we didn't set the quality to 100%. In this case, for example, I set the quality to 90%, and I was able to compress a 500 gigabyte file to a 1 gigabyte file. But I could also set the quality to 20%, and then suddenly I would only need 100 megabytes or 0.1 gigabyte to store this video. So you would think, yeah, why don't we just try to use less megabytes and we can store more episodes on one DVD? But of course, yeah, we set the quality lower. So here, this is an example. If we would reduce it to 100 megabytes, and then the quality is much lower. It's much more pixelated. It's not so pleasant to watch anymore. So video compression, yeah, we need to do this very efficiently. So we need as few bytes as possible to still have a very high quality. So in conclusion, what is video compression? Well, we reduce the file size using a video encoder at the cost of introducing some compression artifacts, some small mistakes in the video that typically we can't see as a human unless if we decrease the quality in the video encoder enormously. So now back to the topic of my thesis, the solutions of the curses of the forensic watermark. So the first curse was the lack of robustness. So recall again that there is a method, the visual watermarking method, where we simply hide some text in the corner of the video, but this can easily be deleted by just blurring it. So now the question that I'm asking is, can we still detect this watermark after it was deleted, after it was blurred, for example? Well, this is what I'm going to talk about now. So recall again, video compression, we have an uncompressed video of 500 gigabytes, and we can compress it to a video of 1 gigabyte, and we don't really see the difference. If I go back and forth between them, we don't see the difference, although actually there are many small compression artifacts. There are many small mistakes being made. So we have this uncompressed, unwatermarked video. Now we can watermark it. So now there is a visible watermark, the text 01 in the lower left corner. So this is the only difference between these two videos. However, you would think this is the only difference, because in the watermarked version, there are also many compression artifacts. These compression artifacts are different than the one from the unwatermarked compressed video. So if I go back and forth between these two, you can see that it's slightly different. The green areas are changing slightly. And again, we didn't see the difference between the uncompressed and the compressed video. And the only difference that we saw between the compressed and the watermarked video was only the text 01. But actually, there are many small compression artifacts that are different. And these small compression artifacts, the difference between them, that is the secondary watermark that I propose to use rather than the primary watermark, which is the visible text in the corner of the video. So in summary, if we have an uncompressed video, we can compress it, and then we have some compression artifacts. We can first watermark it and then compress it, and again, we get some compression artifacts. The thing is that these two are not the same, and that the differences between them, we can use them as a secondary watermark. And the secondary watermark just consists of the different invisible compression artifacts. Then now the question is, if a video is leaked on the Pirate Bay and the watermark was covered. So here we see the lower left corner of a Game of Thrones video with a covered watermark. So there's a black box in front of the number. So we don't know who the pirate is. We can't read this number anymore. But we do have the secondary watermark present in this video. So let's say that we sent 99 different versions to 99 different people, with the watermarks 01 to 99. Well, we can compare this pirated version of the video that we found on the Pirate Bay to each of these 99 watermarked videos. And then we can plot this on a graph, and you can already see that one element here is bigger than all of the rest. One is more correlated than the rest. One is more similar than the rest. And this is watermark number 50. So Jack Sparrow, in this case, leaked this video. Yeah, so this is the detected watermark.
Well, I trust that you will always remember this is the day that Captain Jack Sparrow almost escaped.
So Captain Jack Sparrow thought he was smart and removed the visible watermark before leaking it on the Pirate Bay. But yeah, he almost escaped if it wasn't for my secondary watermark. I still found him. So you may think, Hannes, yeah, good job. But who the hell will use this visible watermarking technique? It's just stupid to distribute videos with like a number in there. It's not nice for people to have something obstructing their view, and it's easy to delete. Well, okay, not easy to delete the secondary watermark, but it's easy to delete the primary one. So I did the same research for an invisible watermarking technique. That's why I went to Australia, where my colleague Palash, or Mr. Azikuzaman, or Dr. Azikuzaman, he has this technique called the DTCWT technique. And I will not go into detail how he did it, because actually I don't really care about how he did it. But if a pirate, it's invisible. So if I go back and forth between these two, the one is the watermarked version and the other one is unwatermarked version, we can't really see a difference. But now let's play pirate. Can we find where the invisible watermark is? because we didn't see it with the human eye. Can we go deeper and find an exploit to remove the invisible watermark? So recall again that a normal video consists of a Y, U, and V channel. So a Y, U, and V channel together forming the colored video. Now we can do the same in the watermarked video. We have a Y, a U, and a V channel. And I went a bit quick, but we see here the U channel kind of looks different from the watermarked video or the unwatermarked video. If I go back and forth, we can see that there is some kind of noise present in the watermarked U channel, while it isn't there in the unwatermarked U channel. And so this is actually the watermark. So I reverse engineered the method. We have an unwatermarked YUV file. So now thinking, what is the DTCWT method actually doing? Is when we have an unwatermarked YUV file, we can split it into a Y, a U, and a V channel. And then only the U channel is watermarked using some watermark ID. And then we get some noisy watermarked U channel. And combining it again with the other unwatermarked Y and V channel, we get again the colored video. Then this colored video, this doesn't look different from the unwatermarked video. But if we look only at the U channel, we can see some differences, some noise. This watermarked YUV file, we can compress it, and then we can send it to the users so that each user gets in a watermarked version of the video. So as a pirate who receives this video, you might think, haha, I reverse engineered the method. I can also hack it because we have this Y, U, and V channel. Well, the U channel is the only one that is watermarked. So a good attack can be to simply delete this U and V channel, and we only keep the Y channel, which is the black and white channel. So this means that we leak a black and white video. Okay, it's not a perfectly nice attack because nobody likes to watch a video in black and white when you have it in color. But it did destroy the watermark, right? There is no more U channel, so there is no more watermark in the video. So.
That's got to be the best part I've ever seen. So it would seem.
So it would seem that I am the best pirate that you've ever seen, because I successfully attacked this invisible watermarking technique by simply removing the U and the V channel and only keeping the unwatermarked Y channel. But now the thing is that my fallback mechanism that I am proposing in my thesis, it actually still works. So if we look at the compression artifacts in this Y channel, so in only the black and white video, the compression artifacts there compared to the compression artifacts in the unwatermarked video, they are still different. And that is because the video encoder, does not only predict blocks of pixels using neighboring blocks, but it also uses the Y, U, and V channel to predict each other. So even when we make changes in the U channel, the compression artifacts from the Y channel will be different as well. So again, we have this secondary watermark, which is present in the Y channel, even though the primary channel was only present in the U channel. The primary watermark was only present in the U channel. So again, in summary, we have an uncompressed video, and we can compress it into a compressed video, and we have some compression artifacts. We can also first invisibly watermark it with the DTCWT method, and we can compress that, so we get some compression artifacts again. And the differences between them, again, I can use these as a secondary watermark. And in the fallback method, simply we can compare the black and white version that we found on the Pirate Bay to the 99 watermarked versions that we distributed, and we see that watermark 50 is much more correlated to the pirated video than all of the others. So we know that Jack Sparrow has leaked the video, even though he deleted the watermarked U channel. So now the question is also, how robust is it against other types of attacks? That's what I also researched more extensively. So let's think of an attack where we simply decrease the quality a lot. From a 1 gigabyte episode of Game of Thrones, for example, we go onto a 50 megabyte. So the quality is very low. You can see many compression artifacts, and you may hope that these strong compression artifacts, that we are not able to see the secondary watermark anymore because it consists of these very light compression artifacts. Well, the primary watermark, you can't detect that anymore because the quality is reduced too much, while my fallback with the secondary watermark is still able to detect it. So 1-0 for me. Now on to some stronger attacks, camcording attacks. Typically, a camcording attack happens in the movie theater, in the cinema, where you use your phone or some other camera to record the big screen, and then you can upload it to the Pirate Bay when it's not even available on DVD yet. So I simulated this, and with an actual camera in Australia, I was recording some TV screen, so I had a good excuse to watch some movies while working. So then we get a video like this. So we see some background, we see the TV, we see some background, the closet where it's standing on, and so on. And then additionally, to make the attack even more strong, I recompress the video so that the quality is a bit lower again as well. So firstly, what do I do to detect the watermark? I register the video. This means that I remove all of the background and I align the perspective again so that it's right, and that we just have this video that we're seeing here. Still, there are many changes. The contrast is not the same, the colors are changed, and so on. So still, the quality is reduced very significantly. Well, the primary watermark, we can't detect it anymore, but the secondary watermark, we can still detect it. So the fallback wins again, 2-0. So I think I can say that the secondary watermark that I'm proposing is in fact robust. So the question was, can we still detect the watermark after it was deleted? The answer is yes, we can, using the fallback detection technique that I proposed that uses secondary watermarks instead of primary watermarks. All right, on to the second curse, the impact on the visual quality. So this means that we want to create a watermarking method that does not decrease the video quality. And the question is not only can we embed a watermark without affecting the quality, we also don't want to affect the video file size. So let's first have a flashback again to my solution to the previous curse, where we used the different compression artifacts between the unwatermarked and watermarked video as a secondary watermark. So now the question that I ask is, do we even need this primary watermark? Can we not just delete it? And then, okay, we have quite twice the same compression, so we would have twice the same compression artifacts. We wouldn't have a secondary watermark to use. But what if we do the compression just slightly differently? In that case, we have different compression artifacts, and we can use that as a watermark representation. So, for example, the video encoder, it decides that this is a good block structure to compress the video, as I discussed before. You have some small blocks around the text Game of Thrones, and then there are bigger blocks where there is more whitish area, and so on. So what I did is simply randomly change some of these coding decisions to this so that the compression is slightly different. So if I go back and forth, you can see that the general block structure, it's changing, but it's not changing all that much. The compression is still happening very efficiently. And in this way, the compression artifacts from an ordinarily compressed video are different than those found in the watermarked compressed video. Watermarked meaning that the compression just happened slightly differently. If I go back and forth, we can see that it's slightly different. So the compression artifacts are different, but again, it's invisible to us. It's both are compressed to the same quality level, so we don't see the difference as a human. Okay, we don't see the difference as a human, but can we quantify this in another way? How invisible is it? How well does a computer need to look to see any differences? And let's compare this to some existing methods. So existing methods, they often need about 2 to 10% more bits to reach the same quality, while my method needs only 0% more bits to reach the same quality, approximately. So this means that my method does not decrease the overall video quality, and it does not increase the video file size. On the other hand, existing methods, either you have to increase the video file size with 10% to get the same quality, or you could kind of say that the quality is reduced with 10% if we want to keep the same file size. So obviously, my method is in fact invisible. The question was, can we embed a watermark without affecting the quality nor the file size? And the answer is yes, we can do this. We can compress the video just slightly differently, and then we get different compression artifacts that we use to represent the watermark. Okay, the third and last curse, the scalability issues. So When we have 1,000 watermarked videos that we want to send to 1,000 people, then we need to do 1,000 times a very slow compression. And of course, this is not scalable because the compression is just too complex to do it 1,000 times. Or if we go even to more users, it's even more of a problem. So the question is, can we compress watermarked videos faster? So we need to think, what does a video encoder actually do to compress a video again? So the video encoder makes some coding decisions at the block structure that I talked about. And here we see some arrows, which is pointing to the previous frame. Where should we copy the block from? How should we predict this block? And if we look at the coding decisions that are made in an unwatermarked video, we can compare it to the coding decisions that are made in a watermarked video. And if I go back and forth between them, you can see there are some changes, but in general, it's kind of the same. Both have like some circular motion going on in the background, and like smaller blocks are used around the details, around the text Game of Thrones, and then bigger blocks are used in the background. And then also another watermarked version still has kind of the same coding decisions. So if I go back and forth between them, again, they are kind of the same, yet not really. The most important thing is that all of these coding decisions are very correlated. In most of the cases, they are kind of the same. And this is what I can exploit to do the compression much faster. So instead of slowly compressing every watermarked video, I want to do the compression only once. I compress only the unwatermarked video. And then I do fast compression for all of the other watermarked videos. And how do I do this? Well, by just reusing the coding information that was calculated in the slowly compressed unwatermarked video. Reusing the coding information means I just copy the coding information from this one and paste it during compression of all of the others. So now all of the watermarked videos have exactly the same coding information. Before I showed you that they all have kind of the same coding information, now they have exactly the same coding information. So in this way, the video encoder doesn't have to make all of these calculations again. But now the question is, how fast is this actually? Well, it is very fast. The fast encoder is about 170 times faster than the slow encoder. So for every slow encoding that we did before, now we can do 170 fast ones. For every user that received their own compressed watermarked video, now 170 users can receive their own video. So in this way, the compression is still very efficient. However, it's slightly less efficient because we're forcing these coding decisions that may not be optimal. So we need about 9% more bits to reach the same quality. This is the price that we have to pay for this immense speedup. And the watermark is still waterproof. It's only slightly less robust. So that's quite cool. The watermark is scalable. It's much, much faster, and we can better deploy it at scale. So again, the answer to the question, can we compress watermarked videos faster? The answer is yes, we can, by simply reusing the coding information. So the conclusion of this thesis, I think I successfully tackled the three curses of the forensic watermark that I was discussing. The first one is the lack of robustness. And how can we summarize that? Well, I think I can let the hobbits do the talking.
What about breakfast?
We've already had it.
We've had one, yes. What about second breakfast?
So Pippin here was onto something. He was asking about second breakfast. And yeah, as people that know me know that that I'm always hungry, so I definitely agree with him. But I don't only agree with him on the topic of breakfast, but also on the topic of watermarks. What about a second watermark? By using a secondary watermark, we can still detect we can still identify the pirate even when he deleted the primary watermark. So in this way, I tackled the first curse, the lack of robustness. Then the second curse was the impact on the visual quality. We wanted to create a watermarking method that was invisible, that didn't decrease the video quality and didn't increase the video file size. How did I do this? Well,
same, same, but different, but still same.
So it's same as the previous curse, like the method that I used for the previous curse, but it's kind of different. Also, it's by doing the compression the same as before, but we do it slightly different. And then still we get the same result. We still get a good quality video. So we do it same, same, but different, but still same. So I think I also effectively tackled this curse. The watermark is invisible. Then lastly, the scalability issues. We wanted to compress watermarked videos much faster, and we succeeded in this by simply copy-pasting the coding information from an unwatermarked, slowly compressed video during the fast compression of all of the watermarked videos. And in this way, watermarking, compressing watermarked videos can be done in a more scalable way. So in conclusion, pirates, beware, because I think we're coming to catch you. And also, I want to finish this presentation by going back to a video that we saw in the beginning.
Sparrow, isn't it?
Captain Jack Sparrow, if you please,
sir. So Jack Sparrow, he's always correcting people when you say his name. It's actually Captain Jack Sparrow. And I hope that by the end of this evening, I can do the same. And when people say Hannes Mareen, I can say hey, Dr. Hannes Mareen. All right. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Hannes, for this very nice presentation. I would like to invite the members of the examination board to switch on their cameras again for the round of questioning. And then we will directly proceed to the questioning. I would like to invite Dr. De Kok to start.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Professor De Skeps. And thank you. Hannes, for a very, I think, a very understandable presentation. Your work is very impressive, also the text itself. And you spent a lot of work on the slides itself to make it understandable and accessible to a wide audience. And that's also the purpose today, of course. Also, it's a very relevant topic, piracy. I think the 17th and 18th century were like the age of the bringing a lot of gold from the New World into Europe. And there was a lot of piracy. These days are the golden age of content creation, where we're getting a lot of new shows and movies that are being imported and also from the New World. And it's that also leads to a situation where there is a market for a lot of piracy. So it's a very hot topic, also for the company that I work in right now. And we definitely need ways to protect the content so that, of course, the people that create it are correctly remunerated. So piracy is far from that, even though that, shows are a lot more easily accessible than, let's say, 10 or 15 years ago. So I'll start with something like a warm-up question. You mentioned in the beginning of your presentation that there are big differences between how you watch video and the type of resolution, for example, that you get. So depending on the way that you're watching, like different browsers, different devices, you might be getting a suboptimal quality. And people don't always realize this. You can press the info button on your Samsung TV, or you have some weird keyboard combination to check out resolution, but most people don't realize it. So maybe they're paying for the highest possible quality, but they're just not getting it at home. So what are your recommendations to watch, let's say, the latest shows on Disney Plus and Netflix under ideal conditions? What devices, what browser should people use?
The problem is that the first thing that I think about is just pirate it, because then you will be sure that you have a good quality. I mean, you can simply see there already all of the options and you can immediately take the best quality. So this is exactly the problem. Like, it's too difficult to know. I mean, it's not too difficult to know, but it's not straightforward to know the answer to this question. Like I said before, like on Google Chrome and Firefox, you're not getting the best quality. So then we have to go to like Edge the native application on Windows 10. But like, I had this problem a few years ago, but I still had Windows 7. And on Windows 7, I didn't have an option to get a higher quality. I had to move to Windows 10 to actually have this higher quality. But in general, so you can get it in this way. And then also, of course, you need a good monitor and you need a special cable that is HDCP compliant, which is secure that you can't copy the video in that way.
I mean, it's true. There's a lot of differences. So using the right browser is very important, and using secure devices. Not all devices are considered secure. So that's something to keep in mind, indeed, for the wide audience. If they want to use watch it in 4K, in true 4K, they're not always getting it. So
Yeah, it's not my intention to stimulate piracy with this presentation.
And by the way, I doubt that you're always getting really good quality with pirated content.
That's true.
So I also, you presented a very elegant solution also, where depending on the type of encoding that you do, you get a recognizable watermark. So it's very easy. But if you need, and it's also, you presented a scalable, like a very fast algorithm, much faster than re-encoding everything. But still, in a practical environment, you might need to encode thousands of different watermarks. So, and encoding, as you said, it's a lot of data, so it's very complex. What would your recommendation be to, let's say, a video on demand provider? A video on demand provider where there's still some constraint in how much encoding they can do and how much storage they can have on their network. What would you tell a Disney Plus and Netflix and others in terms of what they should implement?
Yeah. Well, it depends a little bit on how they see security. Like, what do they think is secure enough? Because as you say, it's very complex to have a separate encoding for every user. So then we can think about solutions that we only need one encoding, and we embed the watermark on the user device itself. So we send the same copy to everybody, and then we watermark it on before we display it on the screen. Of course, then we are with this DRM on our device, like the key that we need to unlock the video. So the key that we need to unlock the video and embed the watermark at the same time. But we know that this can be broken eventually. So this is not fully secure. So I was always focusing my research on ways of doing it in another way. And then the easiest thing is to send a unique copy of the video to every user. But as you said, this is not scalable. Even when I do it much faster, still to do it to millions of users, it's not very scalable. So then there is the other watermarking technique, which is called A/B watermarking. And that is where we only create two watermarked videos. And by first showing the first one A, and then showing the second one B, and then showing the first one A again, and then maybe again A, and then B, and so on, we can create a pattern of A's and B's. And this pattern can be unique for every user, so that then every user can receive a unique video with A's and B's watermarked in there. So that could be a solution, although this is not always fully secure as well. There exist attacks where if we have access to two versions that are A's and B's that are switching, and then we can simply combine the A's and B's from both versions into a new unique A and B sequence. So I don't know, there's not really a one solution that fits for all. You kind of need to think about the advantages and disadvantages of each of them.
Yeah, there's no ideal solution yet, but it might be interesting to take a closer look at those types of techniques, A/B watermarking in combination with your work. Definitely be interested in continuing the conversation there.
Me too.
And then I had a last question, which is more related to different encoder formats and different standards. I mean, there are many different ways in which you can encode a video, and the world is not standing still. We're evolving towards even higher resolutions, like 8K, and some of the people in the audience might already have an 8K TV. And then you need really efficient encoders. You stressed the huge amount of data. You gave numbers on how big data this video actually is. Do you see, two questions. First of all, do you see any problems with different types of video encoders? Because not all encoder schemes are the same. Like you have wavelet-based encoders like JPEG 2000. That's one. And then towards the future, do you see any problems with newer formats like VVC and AV1? Like AV1, for example, has film grain synthesis. So more advanced tools. Do you see problems with both these older and newer formats?
With older formats, you typically have much simpler video encoding, that they just look at a small problem at one frame at a time, at one block at a time, something like that, so that it's much easier to compress the video because we don't need to calculate which is the best block to use for the prediction, for example. But on the other hand, the prediction will be less good, the compression will be less efficient. But so for me, this has a disadvantage that the secondary watermark will have less ways to spread. Because of all the dependencies that are happening in a video encoding process, I am getting these unique compression artifacts that even if we change something in one location, that there are differences in the whole video. So in newer standards, we are seeing the opposite. There is more and more prediction going on from everywhere. There are more tools. The video encoder is very sensitive. If we make one slight change in the coding decision, that this will have an influence on the rest of the encoding process. So with newer codecs, we are also seeing more opportunities for my techniques. Just because of the sensitivity of these video encoders. The secondary watermark will be stronger when we use newer codecs. And also the other types of watermarks that I proposed, they must be stronger in this way. Also, if we think about the scalability, since video encoders are only becoming more complex, by forcing the coding information, we will have an even more immense speed up in this way.
And exactly, that is very important because indeed you have higher resolutions but also more time consuming encoders, so that that becomes even more of a problem. Okay, thank you, Hannes.
And thank you.
I will pass on.
Thank you, Dr. De Kock, for your questions. Dr. De Smet?
Yes.
Okay.
Hi, Hannes. First of all, congratulations with this wonderful thesis. As I've mentioned before, the base ideas in this work could seem a little bit simple in the beginning, and people may have doubt, would this work? But I think that you have excellently shown that these things do work, and things that are counterintuitive, that's my point that I want to make. If you can show that those things work, I think you're doing great science. So congratulations for showing all the things that you have explained to us today. I have two questions, and maybe I will start with the second one first. I think we discussed this before, but I would like to ask the question again. My question is, suppose that you would truly be a pirate. How would you go about in attacking your own method?
Yeah, that's a good question. I always like to play pirate. So my methods are mostly based on these compression artifacts, the small mistakes that are being made. So then we need to look into techniques that remove compression artifacts. And this already exists because, there is, of course, some research. What if we have an old YouTube movie with a lot of compression artifacts? Can we increase the quality? So people before me have already investigated this. So using such techniques, it is possible to try to remove these compression artifacts. And with these techniques becoming better, it could be that also my secondary watermark can easily be removed.
Yes. Maybe a bit more detailed and related to that. I was just wondering that maybe in part of your work, you could have already indicated a possible way of attack. So what I'm thinking about specifically is the method that you discussed for computing the water and the watermarks in a fast way. So by doing a thorough encoding step first and then reusing that information later on, would that not be a good way for an attacker to also attack your scheme by just computing, let's say, an average of what the coder would do and then manipulating some variations based on that?
I think the core ID, it makes sense, of course. But the thing is that this attacker will never have access to the same input video as the one that was used during the watermarking process at, let's say, Disney Plus or something. So the different compression that happens, it's really dependent on the input video that you give it. So the compression artifacts that will be made will be completely different if you give it if you give it a different input video to begin with. So in this recompression process, if we do the same watermarking techniques that I'm proposing, you will get a completely new watermark and it will not destroy the previous one.
Yes, okay. So that was indeed also what I was thinking, that the best way possibly to attack it is by trying to embed another watermark on top of the one that you already may have. But I think we are on the same frequency or page for that. My second question, is more back to my background, forensics. I truly also appreciate all the technical issues that are involved in this, but ultimately some things have to go to court or judge or lawyers, even worse, much worse, lawyers. So there is also the question how to interface some of the technical things with, let's say, the legal aspects of it. So, I was wondering, in a situation where there would be some form of uncertainty, so suppose, as you have indicated just now, that you would launch an attack by doing manipulations on an AB watermarking scheme, how would you go about explaining your method to a judge, let's say, to show that the result, a charge or a décharge, as we say in Belgium, so proving innocence or guilt, how would you go about doing that in court when there would be some kind of uncertainty on the performance of the method?
That is very difficult, of course. I would firstly say that you shouldn't use the watermark as the only proof in court. The watermark should just be the first pointer to where should you look for this pirate. And then when you know who it is, you can actually go to his house and look at his computer and see if he was actually doing all of this piracy, and then use that as actual proof. Using the watermark as proof, the most that I can do now is basically show that for these range of attacks, we showed that my method is resistant against it. So if we detect a watermark with a certain confidence, then we can actually be confident that it was, in fact, this person, or at least this watermarked video that was leaked. But of course, you can never be sure about new attacks that were not covered in my research. Mm-hmm. So in that way, it's more difficult. So I would always suggest that you use only the watermark as a first way of the investigation, a first part of the investigation, and then you need the second part to get the real proof.
Okay, thank you. I think that was you are very quick on your feet. That was an excellent answer, in particular the first. A point that you make indeed, that it's not only about showing something technically, but it's also, let's say, strategic investigative raiding somebody's house. That can also be an important part of the investigation. So thank you very much, and good luck with all your future piracy endeavors or other.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. De Smet, for your questions. Professor Alterman?
Yeah. So I concur with Dr. De Smet that I think your work is of very high quality. I must say it was a pleasure to read it. In a way, you saved me some time, because a lot of other books I have to read, I have to spend a lot of time in grasping it. And that's not because your work is of a low quality or anything, but that's because you are very good at explaining your work very clearly. And I think everybody in the audience today can concur. It's also evident, actually, from the fact that you won an Agoria Prize and that EOS article. These are all things that do not come for free. So that's something I must say I really enjoyed, because that's very pleasant. Now, when it comes to technical questions, I think I've asked you some very in detail questions during the internal defense. I won't do that here today. And the main question I had was actually already asked by my predecessor here today. That was on how would you break your own security scheme. Then I suppose the follow-up question, or the logical follow-up question, is how would you think to secure against an attack that targets compression artifacts? Because compression artifacts, and nowadays you have very advanced techniques to do that, like neural networks, noise-to-noise type schemes, where you remove everything that's not correlated between two video streams. Is there really a way in your mind to protect against that, or to add something else?
Okay, you're catching me a little bit off guard here. I have never really thought about that specifically. Usually we can see that when the compression that we do, when we do it to a really low quality or to a lower quality, then it's just much more difficult to remove the compression artifacts. You will never be able to get it back to a very high quality. So in that way, we're protecting the video better, but we're also sending the users a lower quality video. So this is not an ideal solution, of course, but it is a solution. If I think about another way, it's hard to come up. I mean, there are other watermarking techniques, of course, but really related to my techniques, I think, I can't think of anything.
Yeah, actually, because the issue with a lot of these techniques nowadays to remove compression artifacts is that they things like noise-to-noise, for example, they can work very well in removing two additional signals that are uncorrelated between two videos. So you kind of get a bland, lower quality video that's not particularly even lower quality than any of the input videos, but you wouldn't notice that that the watermark is gone. And that's really a sort of a philosophical issue that you won't be able, so you rely on the things that you can't see, but the things that you can't see is actually the compression artifacts, and these things get removed. So I'm wondering, probably you need to go to some sort of watermark that's hidden in plain sight, like a color change of somebody's shirt in the background. It's there, you can see it, but you don't realize that that's part of the watermark. So it's sort of hidden in the semantics of the video. Are you aware of any work in that direction?
Typically, such techniques, I don't know if this was really proposed, but you would immediately find attacks that if you just have two watermarked versions, you can start to compare them, and you will quickly see that, this person is wearing suddenly a different color of the shirt. Also, it will be very hard to do this in an automatic way because, how can the computer know, if the object or the shirt that we're changing, if it's not important for the storyline? Like if in a CSI episode, if the person in the blue shirt killed the person, well, then we want to know who was wearing the blue shirt. So I can see some issues with that. So typically very visible techniques are also the weaker ones because they're easier to observe and then also to remove.
Yeah, I guess you would need to do it in a pattern of things, but you are right. Content creators absolutely hate it if you propose making actual visible changes to their content. So that's not something we will see tomorrow. Anyway, thanks for your reply. That's my question.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Professor Alterman. Professor De Sutter?
Yes, thank you, Hannes, for your really enjoyable presentation. I concur with the other members of your jury, that your work was of excellent quality and very well explained. So I don't want to reiterate that too much, but I completely concur with them. I do have two questions. One is whether the central concepts that you rely on, compression, artifacts, whether those concepts would also be reusable for other lossy media, like images or music. Music is also often distributed in a lossy way. Do you have you thought about this outside of your own scope of video processing?
So in the beginning, I was also looking at videos of only one frame. So a video of one frame is basically just an image. And then we were seeing that the method was working much worse. And that's because the secondary watermark is it's much smaller. We only have one frame for all of these invisible small mistakes that I use as a secondary watermark. And there are too few of them to really be robust against strong attacks. So in a video, we have so much data that there's so much things to hide that it's relatively easy to make it unique. But the smaller the data, the harder it is to make it unique. So also the less robust it will be. I never looked into music, but I can, I'm not entirely sure how it would work there. If there will be a lot of, if it will be an advanced coder that will compress the music, that also, if you make a change in the first second of the music, that it still will be dependent. There will still be some artifact going further in the song until the end. Then it's certainly possible to use the same techniques as I'm doing. But if like every 5 seconds, there's a complete stop of the compression, then it won't work as good because there's not a lot of data to look at.
I also think that in audio fields only by lossless compressed music.
Yeah, also that. So yeah.
That would also be a problem, I think. I have a second question that's very much related to the question that my two predecessors here asked. When they asked you about specific attacks on your schemes, you started talking about removing artifacts, but implicitly or almost automatically, you only looked at or you only talked about techniques that try to improve image quality. And they try to remove artifacts to improve image quality, which is kind of narrowing the scope of what attackers might want to achieve. Maybe they are not interested in improving the quality, they just want to get rid of the watermark, and there can still be artifacts, not just the ones that point the finger to them, right? Mm-hmm. It's a bit like in software protection, my field. Attackers do not try to undo protections because that's way too complex. They build very custom techniques to bypass protections, to work around them, but they don't try to undo them. So if you broaden the scope a bit, right, and you would go beyond just trying to remove artifacts, and maybe even, I think the other attacks that you discussed, I also see them as kind of off-the-shelf attacks. You use a camera, people use a camera, which is normally used for something else, not for pirating. Attackers recompress. That's another class of attacks that you've discussed. But that's also just reusing a technique that was not meant to pirate movies, right? They just reuse something existing. Is it possible to build targeted attacks that do not aim, that do not reuse off-the-shelf components?
It will certainly be possible. Especially if you know exactly how the method works on a lower level. For example, I had a colleague, Martin, who I'm not sure if he's here because he's at the same time lecturing or assisting in a practical session. But he was actually trying to do such a targeted attack at one point to my method. And that is because he knew how I was detecting the watermark. So I was calculating the correlation in some way. And by just mathematically looking at how I am comparing different videos, he could, targetedly change some aspects to mess with my correlation measure so that I don't detect his video anymore. So I'm not 100% sure about the details anymore, but indeed such target attacks can happen. So in that case, it would be better to have multiple detection measures that do the same thing, but then if one of them is targeted, that at least the other ones are still working, and that hopefully you can't break them all at the same time. So it's certainly possible what you're asking.
And can you, in practice, can you compare the pirates to like attackers in my domain who go from script kiddies that can just reuse tools to gurus that write their own tools to attack software. Do you have the same kind of range of pirates, or are professional pirates not a problem in your domain that would have developed these custom tools like Martin tried to do?
Yeah, I think you do have a range of different people with different expertise in the matter. For example, some videos are leaked, videos from Oscar screenings or from other screener episodes. So videos that are sent to a limited number of people, and they can watch the video before everybody else can watch the video. So for example, for the Oscars or for like reviewers for a new season of Game of Thrones, for example. So then there are really a limited number of people, and typically they are not experts in piracy because they are trusted by others. So there you can, they will not be too smart. The most they can do is download something from the internet and use it to recompress the video or something like that, or blur the visible watermark, which happened. So then that you could call them the script kiddies perhaps. And then, of course, you will have more sophisticated people who are actually actively trying to hack the DRM software of Disney Plus and so on. So now, like also recently, like there was a new movie, The Justice League, Jack Snyder something, I don't even know the title. But I know that it was already available online the first day that it was released. And that is because, there are some gurus, as you might call them, that were actively attacking the DRM software and so on to really do this piracy.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor De Sutter. Then we come to the supervisors. Of course, they have already had a lot of opportunities to discuss with their student and to ask questions, but I wonder whether there are some questions left. Professor Van Wallendaal?
No, for me, no, thank you.
No questions? Professor Lambert? You are muted.
Sorry for that. Well, usually I don't ask questions, and I wasn't planning on asking a question, but I was a bit triggered by my colleagues because a number of questions were about how would you attack your own method? How would you, as Captain Jack Sparrow, attack yourself, let's say? And that triggered me to asking the reverse. Let's say you're James Norrington, so that's the guy from the movie, who's on the army, I think. So would you, knowing that your method works, your secondary watermark is perfect and it survives attack, would you, as a crime fighter, go on the Pirate Bay and go check all those pirated movies, because it's not one title, one pirated title. There are dozens of them. So what would be the total effort, I would say, in successfully fighting all those piracy acts?
So now thinking that I'm not a PhD student anymore from tomorrow on, I would get my own PhD student and let him do all the work. or otherwise, you can build a robot that automatically downloads all the videos that are posted on the Pirate Bay with the title that you have in mind. And then, we can simply try to detect the watermark automatically in this way. Mm-hmm. That should be possible.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thanks. It was a very general and open question, but thanks for your answer.
Thank you, Professor Lambert. So, any more questions from somebody in the examination board? No, it seems not to be the case. Then.
5 minutes later.
Okay, so I will just continue briefly in English. So Hannes, it's a pleasure for me to announce you that we have unanimously decided to grant you the academic degree of Doctor of Computer Science Engineering. So congratulations, Dr. Hannes Mareen. Very nice job.
Thank you.
I must say that the members of your examination board were very enthusiastic about your presentation, but not only about your presentation, of course, also about your work and also about the way in which you answer the questions, both in the internal defense and today. So, very good job. En nu ga ik even overschakelen naar het Nederlands, want een van je promotoren, professor Van Wallendaal, wil nog een paar woorden tot je zeggen. Glenn,
the floor is yours. Dankjewel. Ja, goedenavond iedereen. Ik heb Hannes begeleid, ik zal zeggen, tijdens zijn doctoraat, van het begin tot het einde, samen met professor Peter Lambert. En ik had toch graag een paar woordjes, nog in het Nederlands, als het niet stoort, gezegd over Hannes, een beetje anekdotisch. Er zijn drie, ik zal zeggen, fantastische kwaliteiten die hij heeft in overeenkomst met de drie cursus van het watermerk en van piraterij had ik er graag drie kwaliteiten van Hannes aan toegevoegd en eentje heb ik al direct opgemerkt en dat is zijn fantastische manier om zijn werk op een populaire manier naar buiten te brengen en dat is een kwaliteit die ongelooflijk is en ik hoop dat mensen daarmee inzien dat in het academische domein alleen er toch wel mensen in slagen om op een fantastisch aangename manier moeilijke zaken over te brengen aan anderen. En hij is daar ongelooflijk goed in. En ik heb daar eigenlijk nog nooit gezien iemand die dat op zo'n vlotte, eenvoudige manier complexe zaken kan overbrengen. En een tweede anekdote dat ik wou vertellen, is over Hannes, dat in het begin, als hij zijn masterproef deed, en daarna ook in zijn eerste jaar van de doctoraat, moest ik even wennen aan het feit dat hij heel hard een advocaat van een duivel speelde. Dus hij zocht altijd heel veel kritiek op zijn eigen werk, en ik had altijd schrik dat hij daarmee niet goed op gang ging geraken in hetgeen dat hij doet. Omdat hem zo kritisch was en ik dacht, hij gaat volledig gedemotiveerd zijn door wat het hem doet, omdat hem al de minpunten ziet. En het tegendeel was waar. Dus de moment dat hem alles geanalyseerd had en hij had van alles een goed zicht over wat het er wel en niet goed werkte, dan vertrok hij super gemotiveerd en was hij niet te houden. Dus die efficiëntie waarmee hij werkt, dat was ongelooflijk. En daar wil ik aan toevoegen, als derde puntje, dat die efficiëntie, dat heeft mij echt wel een indruk nagelaten. Een tijdje geleden is mijn collega professor Lambert binnengekomen met het idee, er is een watermerk-app van Telenet genaamd Condom. Dat kan nooit dat goed kan werken. Dat moet te kraken zijn. En Hannes en Martijn hebben dan in no time daar resultaat op gevonden dat wel te kraken valt. En dat was ongelooflijk om te zien hoe efficiënt dat ging. En hetzelfde, nog maar een paar maanden geleden, we hadden het idee voor een onderzoekje te doen en een paper te schrijven. En op 4 maanden tijd realiseert hij dat en doet hij dat. En ik vond dat ongelooflijk. Dat zijn eigenlijk drie punten waarbij ik zo onder de indruk was van zijn capaciteiten. En ik wou dat toch nog vertellen, omdat mensen zien Hannes misschien niet aan het werk en ze krijgen dat van hem ook niet te zien. En moest hij dat vertellen, het zou nog heel stoeverig overkomen. Maar dat is oprecht en het is zeker verdiend dat hem hier vandaag zijn doctoraat haalt en daarbij proficiat. Hannes, ongelooflijk goed gedaan. Dank u.
Hi, dank u voor de mooie woorden, Glenn.
Hannes, dan I think that probably you also want to say something. Misschien wil jij ook nog een paar woorden zeggen.
A bit without words at the moment. I want to say thank you to everybody that gave me the opportunity to get to where I am today. Like Glenn, Peter, also Johan, I don't know if he's here still. They really helped me in building my academic career in helping me to do research, in brainstorming with me. And when I was playing the advocaat van de duivel, then they were always there to be the angel. So thank you for that, really. Also, like the University of Ghent, I think it's just a wonderful employer. Sorry, I'm the employee. That they you really notice that they want you to feel good, and I did feel good during these 4 years of PhD, and I think that is the most important thing. I mean, the research of course is important, but feeling good is even more important. And I always knew that the university wanted to take care of me, and not only the university, also my colleagues. I really had wonderful times with them, both within our small office with the video team, but also outside of that at the lunch table. We had so many nice long lunch breaks and evenings, and then we even went traveling together, and it was really awesome. So especially thank you for that. Also Martin, especially our creative breaks where we threw around some kind of frisbee. It was awesome to do that with you, and just ping pong ideas to each other. That was awesome. Also, my mom, I think I should mention her specifically. She gave me a lot of opportunities in my life to get to where I am today. She made me grow into the person that I am today. She never expected anything in return, and she just made me go in the direction that I wanted to, and always supported me. So specifically, thank you, Mama, for all of that. Also, my friends in general, without you, I mean, after work would not be fun. I really enjoyed our countless activities that we did together, especially in the last year. There's not much to do anymore, so we really needed each other to do awesome biking trips, hiking, walking, kayaking, playing board games, having Skype conversations that can be incredibly demotivating because you don't know what to say because nothing is changing, but at the same time can be incredibly funny. It was really hard times are made better with the right people. So thank you all for that. Yeah, that's about it. I don't know what to say.
Okay, thanks, Hannes, for these beautiful words. So I will now conclude the official part of this meeting. Of course, Hannes, you can still stay afterwards with your family and friends to enjoy the moment. But once more, from myself and your examination board, congratulations. Thank you very much to the examination board, to all the members, and also to all people present here today. In particular, thank you to Pieter and Bart for the questions from the public. That was also very nice. And I wish you all a very nice evening, and take care.